Hey guys, welcome to That Pedal Show, VCQ, Dan here.
Mick here. I don't know why we've taken popular themes as the intro to VCQ, but it seems to work.
I used to play that live at gigs in Brisbane.
Did you?
Yeah, I did.
Nice.
Steve Stevens. Wow! That's the one.
So it's Monday the 21st of January. It's Blue Monday. It's the saddest day of the year for a lot of people.
Monday.
E minor chord. So we thought we'd cheer everybody up a bit. Bit tired now, mate.
So I'm not blue. I'm awesome. We went to Mick and I went to an amazing gig last night. A few months ago, I started working with a tech called Marcus Catanzaro, who was working with Neil Finn, putting together his rig for the Fleetwood Mac tour. And I designed all the power supply stuff for Neil's board.
How cool is that?
And Neil was on tour last night with his son Liam and the rest of the family, and they were playing in Bristol. So Mick and I went along. So we have Liam Finn. Liam Finn.
I thought we were having a TPS crisis.
Elroy Finn. Sharon Finn. And of course, the one and only Neil Finn. Met those guys last night, and just, it was such an extraordinary gig. A massive thank you to Karen Malcolm, who organised for us to go.
Oh, did she?
Yes.
Nice.
And Karen Malcolm's partner is Nick McCabe, a guitar player from The Verve.
Oh, no way.
And he loves the show. So big shout out to Nick.
Be awesome if he could come on.
Yeah?
Yeah.
There you go, Nick. Open invitation.
There you
come
go,
on,
Nick.
Mate.
That'd
be great.
Open invitation.
But I was, honestly, the gig really affected me last night. It was...
I saw you.
Oh, man.
Crying like a...
I did. I had
the crying moments, like a man.
You know, for the first, I started off thinking, sad that I'm not Neil Finn. And then he just was like... He was so cool. So many gigs you go to are really... They can feel a bit elitist. And, like, where the music is like a...
Us and them.
Yeah. Neil had... He got members of the audience to come up on stage.
Had one girl playing the piano.
He pointed to notes for this girl to play, and she was like,
"He's there playing something really complex and singing a beautiful song." And every now and again, he's telling her which note to play, and she's like banging on the keyboard there, on the piano there. And it was a really inclusive thing. And it wasn't, you know, how some artists have got those colossal hits that they sort of refuse to play after a few years. He did cracking set of some really great Crowded House numbers.
Some Split Ends numbers
split
as
ends,
well.
And then then some other kind of newer, more out there stuff, which was really the vision in it and the ambition in it and the artistry in it. I just, wow, more gigs like that, Dan.
But it really felt like everyone was involved.
Yeah, it was wonderful. It was a wonderful show.
He really made everyone feel special for that 2 hours. So as a special treat for TPS fans, the Liam and Neil Finn band are in the UK for another week, and I think they've got like 4 or 5 gigs to go. So if you're looking to get tickets, go to tickets, and if you put in the code on the ticket seller, That Pedal Show, you're guaranteed to get no discount whatsoever. And if you buy one ticket, get the other ticket for exactly the same price. Two videos this week. We had the Wire episode and the
second part of the Strat vlog,
which was wonderful, by the way.
Thank you.
Yeah, really.
It was
really
an interesting thing. I guess there's a question or two. Dan's done the questions today.
Sarang Narayan says, "So the crybaby is true bypass now, and the legend of tone sucking demon is no longer true?" Question mark. And along the same lines, Jonathan Gardner says, "Very interesting episode. I love my wah, but it does present issues. I use an old Thomas Organ crybaby wah with a brown NKT chip, which sounds great, but when not engaged, it degrades the natural tone of the guitar. The tone suck." Right. So the crybaby we use was the original crybaby GCB95.
GCB95 original.
Right. So,
however, there is also one called the GCB95F classic and they're different. And we got ourselves in a bit of a tizzy because we couldn't work out whether it was true bypass or not, because it seemed like it was. And that's what did, that's what began the confusion.
Yep.
Dan headed off down a rabbit hole and discovered this.
Yeah, so basically, this I'm going to do a vlog on the Crybaby, and I'm going to mod the Crybaby. But what happens is, in the circuit that we have, the input is split, and one side goes to a buffer, and that goes to the wire circuit, and the other side of the input goes to one side of this SPDT switch, which is a single pole double throw switch. I'm going to get into that in the vlog. But what happens is, with the Crybaby and bypass, the input is connected directly to the output, but the input is always connected to this buffer. When the switch is switched the other way, then the signal goes through the buffer, through the wire circuit, and to the output. Now, Jonathan Gardner, to answer your question, that buffer, that input buffer, wasn't always there, and the wire circuit has a much lower input impedance, and so. A much lower input impedance than the new version that has this buffer in it. The buffer is basically gives you a 1 meg input impedance. That is loading the guitar all the time, but it's only 1 meg and it's negligible. The difference is the tone that the buffer adds to the circuit.
When it's on.
When it's
the thing that I found hard to understand, that Dan sort of semi-explained to me, and I'm still finding hard to understand, is that even though the buffer is connected to the wah circuit only, mm-hmm. so when the wah pedal is off, you're not hearing the wah circuit, obviously, mm-hmm. and the buffer isn't in the circuit because it's not attached to any sort of output,
yep.
but it's still loading the input.
Exactly.
Because it's connected.
Because it's connected.
And that's the bit that I'm struggling to get my head around because I don't understand electronics. And yeah, so that's what you'll go into in the vlog.
I'm going to mod this... and I'm going to do the tube bypass thing. I'm going to get rid of the buffer. I might do the thing called the vocal mod, which changes the cue a little bit. But I'm going to go through all that in detail. It's the same mod I did in my old Crybaby that Stephen Wilson now uses. But yes, so I'm going to get into that.
Yeah.
But it is really interesting.
Just to underline, just so I finally understand this, the point of confusion is normally in a buffered pedal that is... not true bypass, whether the effect is on or off, the buffer is connected to the output.
That's right.
But in the case of this particular type of Crybaby, the buffer is on when the wire is on, but it's off when the wire is off.
Yes.
And that's not strictly true bypass.
No. Because you're always connected to the input of the buffer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But so not the output.
It's basically the same as having a passive 1 meg ohm volume pedal always in the circuit, you know.
Okay.
So it's, you know, it's not the same, even though the 1 meg ohm it's basically the same input impedance as a Boss pedal. It's not the same as having a Boss pedal in line, because that's buffered all the time, and you have this much lower output impedance that then is always in the signal.
Sorry, I just needed to cheer up a bit there.
Okay. Paul Twistleton.
Yeah, Paul Twistleton says, hello, Paul. Tangent question for VCQ. With advance apologies to everyone more knowledgeable than me, but Dan, please can you explain to me what you mean when you say that the control was set to unity? What is unity? Great show. Thanks, guys. Thank you, Paul.
Paul, unity is when the level is at the same level as your normal level. So... If the pedal is in bypass and I have my signal and then I turn the pedal on and I set that pedal to unity, I'm setting the gain, the output level to the same level as the input level, or the level that when the pedal is bypassed. So it just means matching those levels. Unity, yeah. We're one, we are together.
it can get slightly confusing with gain pedals, because what sounds like unity to you might not actually be the same if you measured it in dB, because different frequencies will present at different types of loudness to you.
Yep.
Certain frequencies will sound louder than others. So, but in the case of what Dan's talking about, it's about balancing the pedal on and off so it's the same volume. So
the full tone deluxe wah has a buffer level in it.
Clyde standard WAF.
The Clyde standard WAF. So when we talk about setting that to Unity, it's just setting that buffer level so that it was the same level as the, when the WAF was off as when it's on. There we go. JD Green 916 says, I noticed that when running two amps, you always have them set next to each other on the same plane. Is that preferable to manage phase cancellation, or is it an aesthetic choice? Very good question.
It's interesting. But by the way, JD Green 916, I'm wondering if you might be a Ducati fan with 916, unless that means something else. And if you are, top of the day to you, sir. I put mine together out of practical reasons because you'd never get much room on stage.
Mm-hmm.
So actually, there isn't even enough room to have them side by side.
Yeah.
So you've got to move. And I liked my sound, certainly in a wet, dry situation, for it all to come from one place.
Mm-hmm.
So it's one homogenous whole. But I guess, I think when Rabia plays, I'm pretty sure, I keep talking about Rabia, God.
You're making up for some honks.
Yeah, sorry, it's a left-handed honk. You'd think as a guitar player you'd have more strength than your left hand, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Anyway, I think he has them either side of the kit because he uses full stereo. And I certainly know Jeff Buckley used to do that, didn't he?
Sure.
Used to do, I wish I could honk Jeff Buckley. Either side of the kit. But yeah, for me, the same, pointing in the same direction. Would be interesting to try one pointing left-right.
The idea is that when you have the two amplifiers together in phase, that the speakers are basically presenting, we're doing this. If I move one of the amplifiers back and I start doing this, then there is a time difference between, those sound waves coming out. So, and that does make a difference. There you go.
Yeah. Okay. Matthew Scanlon. Hello, Matthew. Just wondering, have you done a show with a pedal board for a cover band that does a bit of everything? To be fair, that's my pedal board.
Yeah, but it's still, and my pedal board, because it covers a lot of ground, but it's still a personal thing. A heavy tone that I need for certain tunes is still a personal choice for me. The idea that you can have a pedal board that, that does everything, it's still a personal choice.
And it's still you. How you make that sound.
Yeah.
So it's really your interaction with it. And I think what I find continually fascinating about guitar sound is the, funnily enough, at the gig last night, as an example of this, I can't remember which tune they were playing, but there's a bit where he starts singing the chorus. Neil starts singing the chorus to a song. Liam is doing one harmony. I'm looking around going, wow, who else is singing? No one else is singing. But my brain is filling in all the other harmonies because I know the track so well.
Yeah.
And that definitely, definitely happens with guitar effects, where if you sort of get a wobbly sound, it'll sound right in the minds of the audience. So you can, for me, it's about getting most of the way there at a point which inspires you rather than slavishly trying to get the sound 100% right.
How cool was it when they're doing Four Seasons in One Day? At the very end, Neil breaks the whole thing down and just sings the chorus and gets everyone to sing the chorus. Then he says, right, now sing Tim's part. And
everyone did.
Sang Tim's harmony, and it was...
I've never heard an audience.
Seriously, I'm getting emotional just thinking about it. It was so... I've
never heard an audience sing that in tune.
It was awesome.
It was bonkers.
Okay, Steve Liberty says, Dan, I'm so jealous that you have a cool local music store to go to. Here in NJ, is that New Jersey?
New Jersey.
You mostly have Guitar Center, and while they're okay, it's not the same as going to a mom-and-pop music store where the folks actually know what they're talking about and care about you. I know some good people who work at Guitar Center.
Yeah, me too. Yeah. And I also know a lot of mom-and-pop stores that are truly dreadful.
Yeah.
So I think it's hard to be,
Yes, but he says, cherish the existence of those little music stores as they're disappearing. So Kempsters is the music store in Swindon that I went to. There's a connection there with Kempsters and XTC, which is like one of my favourite bands, them and Crowded House. But look, the first day I arrived in Swindon, I went down to Kempsters just to, and that's where Dave Gregory and Andy Partridge used to hang out on Saturday mornings when they were kids and play guitars and stuff. Yeah, it's wonderful. That's where I met Simon Law as well.
Yeah,
because he used to work at Kempsters.
Good Simon Honk.
It's fabulous.
Nine Nanda. I'd love to see the same demo, but with a big muff. Same issue when putting it after the wah?
I'm going to use a big muff as well when I do the vlog, when I do the mod.
Yeah.
But it's interesting because it's a different thing.
Yeah, and it will depend on which big muff you're talking about as well.
Exactly.
Because some of them were transistor and some of them were op-amp and et cetera, weren't they?
Absolutely.
So yeah, another rabbit hole down which to dive.
Yes. Packer Thomas says, is that Crybaby equipped with the original Facile element? Is there's an audible difference between the model with and the one without. Is there an audible difference between the model with and with one without? The inductor, companies who create their own wah pedals go to a massive effort to, you know, create their own sort of inductor or to get as close to the original inductor as possible. The inductor has a huge impact on the way that the wah sounds, and they're all slightly different.
Yeah, so the difference between the original, which we had, and the classic, which we didn't have, is the classic has true bypass and a Fiesel inductor, Fiesel being the renowned, and I think they come red and yellow or something.
Right.
Different types. Mm-hmm. Anyway, the one we had doesn't. The classic does.
Right.
If that helps. Gawain. Edwards. I wonder if you might be from Wales.
Yes, I'm.
Any chance you can do another show covering auto wahs? I don't have the coordination to pedal a wah and play at the same time, so use a Mad Professor Snow White auto wah. Yeah, I mean, it's a very different thing, isn't it, the auto wah? I noticed that in some stuff that came down from the gig rig the other day, the Analog Man one was in there.
Yeah.
And I don't think we featured that in here yet, so we should do that.
Definitely. Yeah, the auto wahs, auto wahs are great. We did stuff with the Mutron and that sort of a...
Oh, yeah, you know, yeah, yeah.
You know, but that's... I'm assuming this is the auto wah that you can time...
Right.
As well.
Anyway. Yeah, let's do that.
Yeah. The old Tiwa.
A tip for you, Gawain, try the other foot. If you find it difficult, just try the other foot and see if that's any easier.
Right.
Because you never know. Because I can't wah with my left foot, but I can wah semi-successfully with my right foot.
Right.
Yeah.
I couldn't wah for Toffee with my left foot. That just wouldn't happen for me.
Yeah.
Litten Patubin says... I want to use a Ernie Ball volume pedal junior.
I'm working on.
Which has an active buffer in it. My plan was to stick it after my Bud wah, which was that the wah that you were thinking of?
The one I couldn't remember.
When the Bud wah's first in the chain. The buffered volume pedal will, if I understand your clip, mess with all my fuzzers coming after the buffered volume pedal. Is it just germanium fuzzers? Or was it better to have a buffer like in the mix full tone Clyde going into the fuzzers? So yes, if you have the buffer before your fuzzers.
Can we just press you that question a sec? Can you put an active buffered volume pedal before your fuzzers and will it affect it? That's the question, is it?
Yes, yeah. That's the question. And yes, it will affect it. I would try it after. Even after, depending on the fuzzers, will have an effect. The input the impedance relationship with germanium fuzz face is really interesting. It's there's stuff on the input and the output, but it's much less susceptible to tonal change if you use it on the output. But things will brighten up. The answer to all this stuff is that you have to try it, because for some people it works. You know. I much prefer a passive volume pedal in that position, because if you use a passive volume pedal in the front of a fuzz, then you actually can control the gain level, same as you would rolling the volume off. And the tiniest bit of change on the volume on your guitar makes a huge difference when you're talking about
volume fuzz. Pedals has got to go on the list for a show, hasn't it?
Okay, great idea.
Got to.
Yep.
Because I've never, ever used one, and I'm kind of interested.
Okay.
To do some discovering.
Perfect. All right.
Amanda Catherine, you sound very interesting. Mick, you missed a golden opportunity here. The episode was supposed to have been called Are You Here to Fix My Washing Machine? let me just get my large spanner out of this bag. Right? for anyone... au fait with German art films of the 1970s.
James Russo and loads of other people says Kirk Hammett has entered the church. There are loads of Kirk Hammett.
Kirk gets a lot of love for his use of the wild, doesn't he? Actually, he does. Can I honk Kirk Hammett? Yeah, I think I can. Wow. Nice. Okay. Mermaid Man. My problem is my crybaby doesn't cut it when it's after fuzz, and it gives too much of a wah sound and almost no fuzz before fuzz. What can I do? So what he's saying is I don't like it before or after. Mm. Wah and fuzz are my favourite effects, and it sucks that I can't use them together without sounding like beep. Try a different wah and a different fuzz.
So I'm going to do some experiments with this. Try a couple of things in parallel as well, which is another subject that we're going to get onto, because the difference with a wah pedal in front or after fuzz, I mean, it is a massive difference, and there's got to be somewhere in between that I think will work. So there's definitely some experimentation to be done. However, because they all have their own unique flavors and personalities, these fuzz pedals, it is about trying different combinations and trying a few different things that you know might work. Like the Analog Man fuzzes,
I even confused myself during the video, because I preferred the sound of the fuzz before the wah, and I've never done that.
Right.
So I'm thinking, scratching my head, going, my goodness me, I need to go back to the drawing board here and try some things.
Sure, but that also has to do with this, with the sort of wah that's going before.
Yeah, yeah.
So if like with the full tone wah that you're using, with that buffer off, going before the fuzz, you know, is a different thing.
Well, kind of underlines that. I'm not really sure what's going to work here, so I just bought the full tone.
Yeah, and it's there, great. You go. Yeah. And also, one thing that I said was I prefer my wah in front of the fuzzes anyway, because in a dense mix, having that extra top end attack
cut through,
it does work. It does work.
Quick one on my vlog by the looks of things. K-Mo's 1. I like the sound of the Callahan better, but that might be because I kind of wanted to. I suspect the difference may be in the feel of the thing. Loads and loads and loads of people made this point.
So I included this because that's basically summed up all of the comments. There were so many comments on the difference between the Fender and the Callahan. And some people like the Fender and some people like the Callahan. But I love this point that Kamo said he liked the sound of the Callahan better, but that might be because I wanted it to.
Yeah,
I thought that was really interesting.
In all of this, I think, for anyone who doesn't know, there was a vlog earlier in the week where I swapped out my Fender American Vintage Bridge for a Callahan New Bridge on blue on this guitar. And it was really interesting. And as Dan said, people like, oh, God, I way prefer the Fender Bridge. Or, oh, God, I way prefer the Callahan Bridge. Etc. etc. So it's fascinating, and I think a large part of it is definitely psychological. Although there is a palpable tone difference.
There is, absolutely, but it's also a functionality thing. The way that the Callahan feels.
Yeah, it works.
A percentage better
than how I had the Fender one set up. A significant percentage better than how I had the Fender one set up. And I am going to try the raw vintage springs, and I am going to put some slightly softer saddles back on it, because I think it might give it more of that strat back again. Because it is quite hard sounding, and I like that, and it works brilliantly live, but it may be robbing just a tiny bit of sweetness, so I'm going to try that as well.
Awesome. Interesting.
Anyway, thanks so much for all your comments on the strat vlog video. The pickups one will be coming soon, after NAMM, because we've decided to go to NAMM.
We are going to NAMM.
Basically, we said we're not going to NAMM, and then the inbox just started flooding with emails going, why aren't you going to NAMM? We really want to see you. So I'm like, oh, no. So what we decided was we're not going to do extensive filming. We're going to do some vlogs on the phones. We'll do some Instagram posts, but we're not going to do extensive filming because, to be frank about it, it's horrific work that is really unpleasant. And actually, you don't get to do the most valuable thing, which is the whole point of going to NAMM, is talk to people.
Yeah, yeah.
And actually engage with them and learn what's new and talk. So we're going to share a bit.
Yep.
But we're not
Follow us on Instagram. If you want to see what's going on at NAMM, follow us on Instagram, and we will be doing, you know, loads of stuff, you know, regularly on Instagram. But we really want to engage with these guys and, you know, and see where, because there's some, like modulation seems to be the big thing this
year.
Yeah,
modulation. You know? Everyone's gone, oh, look, Thorpe, something else. I've just seen an announcement this morning. Blah, blah, blah. There's quite a lot of modulations coming out. Yeah, anyway, so after all these emails came in, I went on the British Airways website and looked for and got a crazy deal on the flight and the hotel for the week. So we're going to NAMM.
Going to NAMM.
We'll see you in California.
We will do. Chris Dieterman says, I sort of wished you would have tried a Morley while with the optical switch. I'm thinking about going to it because under a serious drive, the click of the switch comes through the amp now and again. Now, the Morley wires, from memory, we have had a Morley wire on the show at some point, but it would have been a long time ago. The thing with the optical switch, and we've got one that has an optical switch here, a volume pedal that has an optical switch. The thing with the optical switch is generally it means it's going to be buffered the whole time.
Right.
Unless the optical switch is turning on a relay or something.
Basically, it means that there's no physical switch in the wire. And as soon as you move it, well, actually, there's two ways. One is you actually do push it down and it turns on using an optical switch instead of a physical switch. Or some of them just turn on automatically as you move.
Yeah, because they're loaded to sit back.
Yeah.
So as soon as you push forward, they turn on. And that's true. The optical switch, there's no big clunk, same as when you use FET switching in your Boss pedals, but they are buffered basically the whole time, so you don't get that clunk. The true bypass thing, that clunk you're talking about, happens with those DPD foot switches.
Essential part of it for me.
Yeah, yeah. You know it's on.
Clunk, now I'm going to use my wire.
There you go. Have a listen to Rolling Stone Satisfaction and the guitar part in that, and listen to the clunk of when he turns on the old FZA fuzz pedal. And it's a part of the track that you know it's there, but until you listen to it, and it's really loud.
And then you can't unhear it.
Yeah, it's brilliant.
Final thing to say on that is quite a few people said about the Wah show, oh, goodness me, classic Wahs, you didn't include colour sound, you didn't include Morley, you didn't include blah, blah, blah. So I think we should do yet another Wah show, which is not Crybaby or Vox Wahs.
Okay, so we've done Crybaby and Vox.
Yeah, we'll have one for reference and then we'll do colour sound and some other stuff.
Perfect, love it. Great.
Okay, Paul Van Hooklom. Why do people leave the back plate off? Is it a better tone? Is it cooler? An interesting question, that. So on the classic Fender Stratocaster guitar, traditionally you would have a plastic plate that's the same as the pickguard material or similar to cover up this thing. Now, I leave mine off because I can't be bothered to take it off and put it back on again.
Right.
Secondly, I'm absolutely convinced it changes the sound of the guitar.
With the backplate on.
Yeah, because these springs have an audible reverb in the guitar, right?
Yes.
Thirdly, sometimes if you don't like that audible reverb and it's against your clothing, they don't vibrate so much.
Right.
Oh, okay. So that's why I leave mine off.
Interesting.
Yeah, John Mayer thinks it sounds better. Eric Johnson thinks it sounds better. Who are we to argue with them? John Mayer, Eric Johnson.
I met Eric Johnson last time we went to NAMM. He's such a lovely guy. Paul Ludwikowski and DeGoat1 were asking, do you guys have any idea which NKT red dot that you have? Analog Man has three different ones. Seems to be standard, medium gain, and medium high gain. Thanks. Pretty sure ours is the standard.
Pretty sure mine's a standard.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And if you set it as the way you should set a fuzz face, i.e. at kind of like that on both knobs, or like between there and there on both knobs, mm-hmm. is where they work for me anyway.
Yeah.
But again, then it depends massively how you have the input impedance trimmer. Is it input impedance trimmer? Resistance? Is it impedance or resistance?
So if you're going into the input, there's a resistor on there. It's like a pot, and it just changes the amount of resistance between your guitar signal and the input.
And that makes a massive difference too. Also the sundial. So I would imagine if you just get the standard one, and then you can tweak it there. It depends how much gain you want in it, really.
Sure.
But they're pretty gainy anyway.
Yeah.
Matt Burdock, hello Matt. It makes you wonder if you've watched too much TPS when Mick can't remember what used to be his favourite war, and you're sitting here shouting, "It was a Buddha!" at the laptop. Yeah, I'm sure there were a chorus of, if you listen quietly across the globe, 100 however many thousand people were going, "Buddha, Buddha, Buddha." Yeah, it was a boudoir by Buddha, purple.
Yeah, great sounding thing.
And then they changed the shape of it and I lost all interest.
Right.
So, yeah.
Food for the Gods says, "Hey guys, this is a bit off topic. How do I tell the guitarist in my band that their sound is bad without sounding like an idiot? I'm the bassist, by the way, if that helps."
I have an answer for this. Do you have an answer?
I don't. Please go.
Buy him a That Pedal Show t-shirt.
Nice! Very nice.
In fact, tell you what, Food for the Gods, if you email That Pedal Show store...
We'll send one to
with
him.
..your... name, and I can prove that it is you, I'll send you one for free that you can give to him and subtly encourage him to watch the show, maybe, and who knows, he might enjoy it.
There you go.
Yeah,
that's the best we can do.
If the thing is, this is all, I mean, he might sound awesome already, it just might be that your idea of a great sound and his idea of a great sound are two different things, but you know, we're here to help.
There
is all I'm saying.
Yep, that's great.
David Kiletkia. Oh, blimey, we've got some great names today, Dan. I apologise for our regiocentrism in that we're very British and Australian.
Very British and Australian.
Yeah, yeah, we just have simple words, you know. Anyway, David Kieltia. And Nathan Gifford say, "Watching you guys figure things out in real time is a big part of the enjoyment I get from watching these videos. Real folks doing real stuff." I'm really pleased you said that.
Yeah, yeah. Just, we don't pretend we know everything.
No, and I certainly don't when it comes to that stuff.
Yeah.
So, yeah. We're
all on this voyage of discovery, people.
The flip side of that is when someone goes, "Oh, God, your videos are too long." It's like, well, okay, maybe you're not... Maybe you just want to not be down this rabbit hole and that's cool, go and watch something else.
Yeah.
But for all of us who do and want to go through the process, I also think it... Sometimes you can feel really stupid... I can remember feeling really stupid wanting to try new stuff and not knowing what questions to ask. Or if you go into a guitar store, an old-fashioned guitar store, and still some guitar stores today, and you ask those basic questions, you do get treated badly, or you can get treated badly. And God help you if you ask a question on a forum.
I can't do forums. I used to do
you do not deserve to be in this forum, man. And all of that, like the comic guy in The Simpsons. "You are an amoeba on the bottom of my shoe." Etc. Photography forums are a million times worse, by the way. I was just thinking about, does this converter work on this Canon lens to this Sony body? "You amoeba, you do not deserve to be here. Get out of my forum now. IQ will be terrible." Image quality.
Right.
So, good. I'm glad you said it, and we'll continue to do it, and we'll continue to try and be on your side so you don't feel... stupid figuring this stuff out.
Yeah. So Joe Santos again, regarding the fuzz, either before or after the wah, would we experience the same difference using op amp fuzzes like Big Muff as opposed to silicon or germanium fuzzes? Again, the vlog that I do when I'm modding the Crybaby, I'm going to get into that. And also, we mentioned about getting Justin guitar.
Yeah, Justin Sandico.
So it's been a couple of years that we've had a dialogue about him coming on. So we will do that.
Yeah, we'll
so many people commented.
Reach out to him, man.
Big fans of Justin's work. You know, he's amazing. So, yeah, let's get him on. That'd be great.
Would be great. Is this the final show?
And
the final question?
Final one, yep.
"Hey, Dan, when building boards, I know you often put wah off the board. Do you still do that with the Crybaby mini wahs?"
If you can justify the space on your board for a Crybaby mini wah, I can't with any wah simply because I use it so infrequently.
Yeah.
But it's just about justifying the space on the board. That's all. I have the wah off the board, battery in it, and if I'm doing a set that requires the wah, I plug it in. But most of the time, it's not there.
Same.
Yep.
Right. So I think we should... go to California, Dan.
All right, let's do it. We'll see you guys in there.